Hello and welcome to a brand new episode of The Morning After the Euros. I have got my first shot of my vaccine and I'm about to doze off. So before I do that, let's really like take this off and preview the pre-quarterfinals, the round of 16, as we say, in whichever part of the world or wherever
Don't
you
have
are.
the word, perfect word for it. Like quarterfinals is perfect, like as a word. Quarterfinal, semi-final, final. We don't have a word for the round of 16 that really rolls off the tongue.
Yeah. Don't they say it like pre-quarterfinals? It doesn't make any sense even.
I'm not a fan of pre-quarters or round of 16. I was listening to a podcast in which they were discussing that actually. Like what word should be used? Like they were using some Spanish word. Like there is a Spanish word for it apparently. Like I obviously don't know what it is, but I'm poor with languages anyways. So like there is a particular word that sounds pretty awesome for the round of 16 that they use. And yeah, that's all the information I know. Like, if anybody wants to, is interested, they can check it out on Google or just Google it or something. I don't know.
I think if I'm not mistaken, I always get it wrong, but in German it is called Achtelfinale, which is like finals of the eights, because
I like that. I like that.
it's eight matches, and then the quarterfinal is called the Vierte Finale, which is like four
Four
finals.
finals. That I like the way the hierarchy of that, how that works. I like it. Acta Ferrare. Ferrare or finale?
Finale.
Finale. Okay. Okay. Yeah. I like that. Yeah.
It's a difficult language, but so much like makes sense as to how this language is like should be learned and originates, because there's just a word for somebody who is happy at your demise, or like I am happy that you are having a fucked up life. So, and then there's just a word, but in English you have to describe like, yeah, I'm glad that you're having a shitty life. Is there a word in English for that? Anyways,
Well, you could use the word spite or something like that. Like, I don't know. Or, oh no, but that's not an exact word. Like, you're right. Yeah. You're right. I get your point. Yeah.
Nah, okay. We have the actual finale or the pre-quarterfinals to preview, and let's go for it. Like, the first game, which is going to be played on a Sunday, is good.
Saturday, no, Saturday night.
Is
Saturday
it?
we have,
Oh yeah,
yeah.
26th. Wales is playing Denmark, pretty favorable. I'm still like, I'll just give it to you. Denmark should make it. And then Italy is playing Austria. Let's preview this one. I think
No,
it's.
let's talk about Wales Denmark first. I don't think it's a sure shot. Like, do you think so?
For me, Denmark should make it. I don't know. Are you going to make
Okay.
a case for Wales? Make a case for Wales then.
Yeah, like I think this Welsh team is pretty interesting. Like what I was surprised by the most is the fact that they can defend well. Like they were pretty good against Italy while defending, weren't they? And they're not excellent or top class or something like that, but they give it a fight. Like they had what Scotland kind of lacked a bit, like this Welsh team. And another thing that I realized is they have players who have the know-how, like having Bale and Ramsey, those superstars who are willing to carry you. Like that makes a difference, and there's a harmony to this team. I enjoy a lot of factors about this Welsh team, and I love the fact how they've used each of their players. Like the players that have been put in, they have put in a shift. Like anybody, like Daniel James hasn't had the most spectacular tournament on paper, but every game that he's played well. And from that perspective, when I look at it, I think this will be a good game. Like I'm excited for this. This should be a fun watch.
It's going to be a fun watch, but
Yeah.
because football is not played on paper, but also then you can
Yeah.
say it's you can't bring like all your emotions together for one game. But
Yeah.
if you compare player to player, Denmark have clearly
Oh
better.
yeah, no, I'm not denying that at all. Like I understand your point perfectly, but my point is it's actually from when you look at it from the harmony and the teammate point of view, and like we got all the answers we needed in that 4-1, right? Like the Denmark 4 or Russia 1, like the emotion that was there. Like I didn't surprisingly I didn't feel the emotion while I was watching the game. I was a bit distracted or something, but then I went back and watched the highlights. And I realized, that's when I realized, because I think we had talked about it as well, And like you talked about the emotion, then I was listening to a podcast and they were talking about it as well. And then I realized, yeah, that there was something palpable, like you could feel it. Like there was something in on that pitch and in that crowd, and like there was a presence there,
yeah,
like something that can't be explained. And that I realized that a bit later, and I think that is why I don't know, like Denmark is the better team, but I won't count Wales out. That's all. I just wanted to make the case that that's it.
Cool. Yeah, we can agree to disagree on this one, because I also feel that they should have rolled over. They should have rolled over Finland, but of course things happened and they couldn't. Then they made it difficult for them. Anyways, the second game versus Belgium was difficult for them.
Yeah. We've been through this. Like we know what happened. Yeah. Like,
but how you are comparing like Wales making it difficult for Italy? Denmark were no pushovers for Belgium as well. So,
definitely.
Yeah. So that's why I'm making my
case. Promising for us, right? It makes a good it feels like two teams that, like, they might not be equal. I'm not suggesting that they are, like, the Danish are definitely the better side, but it will be a competitive game, and it will be a game where two teams will go at each other. Like there is no pragmatism, and they'll fight it, and it'll be a showdown kind of thing, right?
Yeah, true.
So
yeah,
it should be fun to watch.
Yeah. So a nice matchup here. The next day, or the very day, Italy is playing Austria. This should,
This is easy. Yeah, we've discussed this Austrian side before. They are a bit of a mess. Like they played well in their last game, but I still don't buy that they asked David Alaba too much, in my opinion. And this Italy side will roll them over quite easily.
Yeah.
That's just how I see it. Yeah.
I think this is the only, in these eight matches, there are only two mismatchups, which is this one. But of course, both of us are not going to make a case for Austria anyways. They were lucky enough to like make it through at the expense of Ukraine, who also made it through eventually. So
yeah, they did.
And I feel Austria.
Like, what's the jeopardy, man? Like, I still hate that. Like that, like the fact that Ukraine are there, it pisses me off, honestly.
Yeah, I feel. And also the fact that Austria finished second, they have to play Italy, and Ukraine finished third, but they play Sweden. So I get your point.
I mean,
now
being third is better, isn't it?
Yeah, like, I get
so
your point.
Stupid, man. I can't believe it. Like, it's
all right. Yeah. Anything else to add to this one? Like, are is there
to be fair, Sweden topped their group, so it's not like it's an ironical situation here. Like, just to be fair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I'm just thinking about Italy. Like, is there a way that this could not be a one-sided game? And like, what is the possibility?
Well, yeah, there is one way, but the problem is Austria does not have that weapon. Austria is not we discussed this before. We should make this point again. The Italy backline can be challenged. They do not have the speed and the pace in the center backs. So there is a hole there that can be exploited. But the problem with that hole is Austria does not have the weapons to exploit it. Like, Seferovic is an underwhelming player at best. Jordan Shaqiri is good. He's skillful. He's talented and all those things. But he's not fast and quick.
Hey, even in Shaqiri making him. Why are you talking about
Switzerland? Oh, sorry. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I got confused with Switzerland. I'm so sorry.
Yeah, no worries.
Oh, shit. Even Seferovic is there. Oh, my God. What's wrong with me? Yeah. So who was attacking for, who was the striker for Austria?
Sabitzer, are you talking about?
Sabitzer is also not that kind of. Sabitzer is even more different than Shaqiri. Like, Shaqiri might dribble, but Sabitzer is completely pass first player. And David Alaba, it's a crossing team, right? Like basically that's how they attempt to score goals.
Baumgartner, and the one who scored in the last game.
Yeah. I apologize, man. I completely lost track.
No worries. Yeah.
Yeah. I just.
Wow, Switzerland are out, actually. Okay. No,
they are there. They play France. Oh. They were just below. That's why I got confused.
Yeah, and also Austria and Switzerland, like.
Yeah, the Austria, like, it's a common mistake, isn't it? I shouldn't say that, but but who I don't even, I can't remember who plays strike for Austria. I'm just completely blanking.
Arnautovic, Christoph Baumgartner.
Oh yeah, Arnautovic. Okay, Arnautovic might be a bit of a threat, honestly. Like, you don't know. We don't know what but yeah, like, they were able to handle Bale. I'm pretty sure they'll be able to handle Arnautovic. Like,
yeah. he's nothing special.
And another problem is that I think that this has to be, this will become a huge factor because Chiellini's tournament is basically done, right? Like he can, that would be a miss. Like they're old, but the thing is they're still one of the best center back. Both of them, Bonucci and Chiellini, are but the best in the top 10 of center backs for the past decade. So
yeah,
missing one of the top best center backs of the past decade is always going to be a loss. So there are holes that can be exploited. But the midfield trio, the balance that this team has, and the way Mancini is making them play, the recklessness is a positive.
Yeah.
And I've turned around quite a bit on this Italy team, actually. Hearing about the squad, hearing how they approach this, hearing how Mancini approaches this, they are one of the favorites, and I think they should sweep this team aside.
Yeah. Another factor that goes... It's not a big factor, but they are not playing in Rome anymore. So they're going to Wembley. So in case Austria wants to take advantage of that fact, big pitch. I mean, Rome is also a big big pitch. So in terms of the pitch, it shouldn't be much of a difference. But just having that feeling of...
Yeah, but the home crowd is always an advantage, even though if it's 10,000 or whatever the number was.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then we go to the Puskas Arena, where in Budapest, where Netherlands is playing Czech Republic. Netherlands also playing their first game outside Amsterdam Arena. But they should be okay here with unless.
Yeah, that's a comfortable fixture. That's a mismatch. Like Netherlands are lucky that way, aren't they? They got the mismatch. Like they're group topping the group. Like if it set them up quite well on the path to going into the semi-finals of this tournament, and like they should be able to handle this Czech team. Like this Czech team is good. They give it a fight. Patrick Schick has always got something up his sleeve, but Netherlands have four players who are equivalent to what Patrick Schick provides. Like Memphis Depay has been irresistible in the past two games, and Dumfries has been an excellent contributor and the hardest man to track on the pitch in the games against Netherlands.
Yeah,
and
Wijnaldum
is Genie Wijnaldum, who's one of the best Dutch players of the past few years. Like.
Delict has come in and he's done very well.
Delict has come in and stabilized the defense. Like Delict was kind of written off, wasn't he? Like after his first season with Juventus. Nobody really talks about him at all. Mm-hmm. And Frenkie de Jong, we know, like the midfielder is there. Damn, this Dutch team is good. I just hate the coach so much.
Okay, the coach is the only problem because... and.
He's done well though. Like I have credit where credit's due. I don't think... And... Deschamps didn't have a great reputation before the World Cup, to be honest. Like, did he?
No.
So,
yeah.
Well, yeah. Maybe Frank de Boer turns his coaching career around. He's done well at Ajax, so you never know.
I mean, I don't want to say like everybody does well at Ajax, but yeah. And then the number one team in the world is playing number five. The mouth-watering clash of the pre-quarterfinals in Sevilla.
Oh,
Belgium entertained Portugal.
To be awesome.
You could bet on Ronaldo scoring one goal because he always scores against Sevilla, and if that
they'll get a penalty.
Yeah. Okay. But yeah, De Bruyne and try to stop these two, man. De Bruyne and Lukaku.
Yeah. Ruben Diaz goes against Kevin De Bruyne. That's exciting, isn't it? The two best players of the past season in the Premier League, at least.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be, and I want to see how these guys handle Lukaku because I don't know, like if Portugal are not able to handle Lukaku, do you think anybody in this tournament can? Because Portugal is one of the better defending sides. Like you have Pepe and Ruben Dias, that's a great combination, and the fullbacks also contribute to. They're not great fullbacks. Like that's the weak point of this team. Rafael Guerrero is excellent attacking, but he's not great defensively, and Semedo is just blah. So,
Semedo was.
I must say, like, if Lukaku rolls, then Lukaku is going to roll to a long way in this tournament.
Yeah, true. Yeah, it's a very difficult one to call, man. I'm not sure.
It is difficult to call. Yeah, I honestly think Portugal is going to win this.
I want to make a case for both of them. Like, I already made a case.
Oh yeah, that's an easy case to make either side.
Because. These two are in form, so Belgium should be okay. Then I'm also we were worried about Belgium's
The backline is a question mark. And Ronaldo is... Bruno Fernandes will have to play this one because that backline is there for the taking. Like, if they go defensive... Like, Renato Sanchez, I think, is undroppable after the last game. Mm-hmm. And I think Bruno Fernandes should be there with him in that 4-1-4-1 type setup that they have. Okay. And... Yeah, that's what the paper says, at least. Technically, that's how they set up. Because Renato Sanchez was quite further up and Moutinho was with him there. And I think William Carvalho was the one. No, Danilo Pereira was the one sitting back.
Moutinho shouldn't, like, if... And they don't. He doesn't have the...
Yeah, I wouldn't expect Moutinho to play. But I think Moutinho can't keep up with De Bruyne. And, like, the midfield is too much for... Tielemans also, like, I don't think he can handle. Alex, Yeah, Witzel has also come back. Yeah, that's a solid, solid midfield. Oh, I hate that defense so much. Like, it's going to undermine this Belgium team. And maybe this is the game where it happens.
Yeah. We still haven't called it. And that's how good that game is. So
we better not call it. It is... I pick my side. I'll pick Portugal. Like, just so that, like I, one side is, my head is going, one side my heart is going. I want Lukaku to do well. Like, since he's left Manchester United, I've always wanted the best for him and I'm loving that he's doing well.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it might sound kind of like a sore loser kind of thing, but he was good and he was, it just wasn't the right fit. That's just how I looked at it. And, I'm really happy for him and I want to see him smash Portugal, that's all. But yeah, like, I'm going to pick Portugal for that exact reason.
Okay, and then the last time these guys played each other, I think was in the, of course, the Nations League, where Spain actually spanked Croatia 6-0. But also then
you didn't make your choice. You haven't picked the Belgium Portugal pick. Make your pick.
Oh man, I'm Belgium.
nah, I'm going to hold you to it. You pick Belgium now.
Calling Belgium. Yeah.
Yeah, let's talk about Croatia Spain. Okay, this is going to be a fascinating fixture. Like, two teams who have been underwhelming to say the least.
Oh yeah. And it's also a rematch, not exactly rematch, but they played each other in the 16 group stages, and Croatia, that golden generation, like, and the dying Spain generation, they walked, they literally, like, ran them off the pitch and they won like 2-1. So
I remember that game. Croatia was clearly the better team that day. There was no denying that.
And there's big history in, like, at least in European Championship, because I remember in 2012 as well, they played each other in the European Championship and Spain won. This was also in the group stages. So Spain won 1-0 there.
Yeah.
Then that was 2012. Then 2016, Croatia won 2-1. So again, the knockout stages. Like, head to head, anyways, it's very close to call. Both have played 4 times, 1-2, lost 2. So a close one. Ooh.
Yeah. Well, honestly, like, these two teams were terrible in the first 2 games. Like, we can both, I think we can agree on that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, the last game that they played, I think the Spain 5-0, that's just that was terrible by Slovakia. Like, I will not give Spain much credit for that win. Like, they were, that Slovakia team basically opened the floodgates for them. Like, that was terrible. Like, what Slovakia did, I mean, what was going on? Like, why did they such a good chance of qualifying? They could have been there instead of Ukraine if they had just held up defensively against Spain.
True.
And I mean, so ridiculous, like, what performance they put up. And Croatia rolled over game Scotland team. At least Scotland were game. They lost the game. They lost the match and they were knocked out. But Scotland gave them a fight. And honestly, I think Croatia might have that advantage that they've been through more battles, because Spain still haven't figured out what they're supposed to do. I don't think so. I still don't think so.
Busquets was a big help. That's what I thought. Like,
that kind of player makes a change, right? When, that's kind of what Busquets' speciality is. Like, just moving the ball a bit quicker, it gives the other players a bit more time, and that's how you create half chances, and that's how you create half spaces. Like, that's the beauty about a player like Busquets, and
Yeah.
Like, just that half a second, sometimes it's the difference. And Yeah, Busquets will definitely start that game. I think as long as Busquets can walk and actually pass the ball with that, giving you that half a second, yeah. Busquets will be in the team, whichever team he's playing for.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think I still think Croatia have a bit of the edge. But okay. Obviously, on paper, the Spain squad is more talented.
Okay, what are you calling?
I'll call Croatia. It's a hard one to pick. But yeah, I'm not going to wonder too much. Like, what's the worst that could happen? I'm wrong. Who cares?
Calling for Spain. Okay, good. We are not agreeing on a lot of this. But we are going to agree on this one. Although we...
Okay. I'm interesting. I thought you'll pick Spain.
No. Not the next one which is coming. I'm picking Spain anyways.
Okay, you pick Spain. Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah.
They were my dog horses for, and I need to stick to that.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, like yeah, you. I expected more from Spain. So yeah, I'm not going to be like well. What do you?
Both the countries I'm supporting, anyways, are being so underwhelming. By the way, I never asked you who are you backing, like Portugal all the way or?
Oh, okay, yeah, but I actually haven't thought too much about this question. Like, when I don't really have a horse, like I don't really care too much about who wins. Like ever initially, Italy was the team I really supported, but like Italy is the team I wanted to win because I thought nobody would pick them. And then now looking at this Italian side and how much favor they've curried from the public, I don't want to pick them.
Yeah.
And that's just how I thought of this. And fuck it. I'll take England.
Oh my God, don't say that. Okay, that's the end of the show, guys.
I don't care, honestly. But, I don't care, man. I'm telling you, I don't care. Like, it means nothing to me. Like, whoever wins.
He's one of
It's not who's... like it's not basketball or something where I actually have a few favorites, like who I really want to win. I watch football more as an analyst, and I don't have a particular team to root for. I just don't root much for any team. Like, like if Martial was playing, I'd have rooted for France. But Martial isn't in the squad, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. What am I supposed to do? Like all my. Who's my favorite player then? Maybe I'll just pick the team with my favorite player. Like, who is my favorite player?
Who you tried to knock them out just now?
Yeah. Nah, I can't do that, right? Like, that's a bit too much, isn't it? Like, I'm actually on call, like on the podcast, thinking about which team I should pick to win this.
We'll give you some more time.
Yeah, actually, give me a bit more time. Once you ask me this question next again, episode. Once we are done with the preview.
Next episode. Yeah. Next episode, I'll ask you.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah.
Yeah. All right, next one. France rolling over Switzerland. I still expect, like, I'm just going for a freak and saying that Switzerland are going to like 4-1, and then France are going to win like after the 80th minute. That's my call.
That's a big one. Like, it's an interesting France, call to say that.
Because this France squad. I mean, everybody's scared of them. And because they're so scared of them, they are not like actually giving it a go. When actually you could like really test them. They're really good.
They are sleepwalking a bit, I think. Yeah. Except for Pogba, nobody in that team has been consistently awesome. Like, like N'Golo Kante is the kind of player who you would never really consider as awesome. Because like in the sense that when you're watching the game, because he's so... And I think another weird thing that I realized about Conte is, I don't know if you agree, he's giving away a lot of fouls in this tournament, isn't he?
Yeah.
Like, you generally don't expect that from him. So,
he's mistiming them and then...
Like, maybe that just proves he's human. Like, after a certain point of time, you'll even kill N'Golo Kante. That tells you how much pressure and how much workload these guys have been put under. Yeah. That N'Golo Kante is fading a bit. I mean, unimaginable sentence, isn't it?
True. Yeah. Any making a case for Switzerland or no?
Nah. Like, what case is there to be made? Like, what am I supposed to believe that Seferovic, who will somehow inexplicably start again over anybody else they could have picked? Like he scored in the last game, fine. But he still put in two absolutely abysmal showings. And Shaqiri picked up his game. I think Shaqiri did his one game to prove that he still got it.
Yeah,
so that he can actually get a move to Crystal Palace or something like that, somewhere where he can play.
Yeah,
and
he does that all
because he has to get out of Liverpool. Like, play, man. Like, what's the point? Like, just it's not helpful to anyone, honestly. Shaqiri just being there at Liverpool and barely showing his face on the pitch. He's a good, talented player. He's fun to watch. Like, may as well enjoy and let the fans appreciate your game. So, I think Shaqiri's. I don't think they're going to be able to do much though. They just can't challenge the France side. Like,
yeah,
it's Portugal had such a hard time breaking them down, and I mean, I don't see Switzerland having even a single chance, like not a chance created in that sense, like having even a small percentage of probability where they could win this. Nah, it's very hard to buy for me.
And the final two games, this one, if England beats Germany, I retire officially from football, watching football, commentating on it, making podcasts. I will give up on my footballing life. I don't want to see
that.
Oh,
man.
I don't
No. You're putting too much on one single game. I mean, it's a game of football at the end of the day. Anything can happen.
Dude,
like,
these guys are still talking about Munich 2001, that 5-1 where Michael Owen ran the show until now. And
what is there to talk about that? Like, what? Like,
and it was a friend.
Then there are like four different times Germany beat them up after it, isn't it? Like, I remember I was supporting England in that 2010 game where Frank Lampard hit the bar and it wasn't counted.
Yeah.
And then Germany took over and brutalized them. Mm-hmm. Like, England didn't have a peep after it. Like, that was disgusting what Germany did to them.
Yeah, Thomas Muller, that young guy.
Oh my God, they ruined them. I remember that game. Yeah. Oh my God.
Yeah. Nobody talks about that one. But everybody wants to talk about the 5-1 that happened like 2 decades ago.
Yeah, well, that's kind of a positive. Look at it as a positive, right? You talk about it when you know you're not good enough. Like, you're not better than the opposition. That's the approach people take when... Dude, like, okay, let's just be absolutely clear about this. Why do the English keep hyping up their wins like 5-1 and not talking about World Cup games and World Cup championships they've won and things they've done? Like, things that are actually tangibly they've done. Because they haven't won anything. This team hasn't won shit since Bobby Charlton was 27, 28 years old. He might have been 32. I don't remember his exact age at the time. I mean, Bobby Charlton has been diagnosed with dementia and has had a couple of brushes with death since then. Like, I mean, Alex Ferguson was 18, 19. He was playing in Govan like he was a youngster. He was trying to get into Rangers, I think.
Mm.
No. He was already coaching at that time. He was already coaching.
Yeah.
He was coaching at before St. Mirren, I think. Like, that was his first team. Like, I'm pretty sure nobody would know this. It's called Al's United or something like that. Like, Air United, AYR, Air United. That was the team he was coaching or something like that. That's the time period we're talking about. Okay. That's when England last won a trophy. So... It's pathetic. Like look at any sport that England actually plays and tries to compete in. Cricket, they taught us how to play the game of cricket, like me and you, like our country. We're Indian, obviously. And now we have three different squads that we can put out that can beat the English wherever you want them to. Like, I mean, they are a joke. They're a joke. Like, I want, like, this hype and this nonsense, right? Like, just shut this down, man. Like, calm down. You're not elite. You're not elite when you don't win anything for 50 years. Don't you dare call yourself elite.
55.
Yeah. I mean, it's a joke.
Anyway,
I might have gone too far, but it's a joke, man. Like, it's like, even a World Cup final, I would have counted. Yeah, give me a final.
You have gone far. And what about them, like, going far shamelessly, the audacity for them to like proclaim their miscrowned glory or the crown that always seems to be denying them or denying the throne to which they think that they have the right to sit on top of it without actually like being good enough. How are you like pushing it? I don't get it.
Yeah, no, okay. I another thing we can talk about here, like, now that we're completely brutalizing them, may as well go, like, may as well take it another step.
Okay.
So there's a term, right, in sports that we talk about. There's a genetic element. Like, you need to learn how to win, right? Like, basketball is big on this. I think I've talked to you about this a bit before, right? there is, you need to learn how to win. It's passed on from player to player. Like for example, when Lakers won last year, the NBA championship, right? LeBron had learned how to win a championship and he passed it on to Anthony Davis. And there is a succession plan in these kinds of things.
Yeah.
Where is England's succession plan? Who is going to teach that English team how to win? When the guy who actually won, like they won under Sir Alf Ramsey, right? And Sir Alf Ramsey was their manager at the time, their coach. The players were Bobby Charlton and Bobby Moore and like historically great players. They have done and finished, and like their era of management also is over a long time ago. And most of them weren't really big in management. Like Nobby Styles was a coach for Manchester United. He was never head coach or anything. Like the next stage of managers came in, Ferguson, Jock Stein, and Kenny Dalglish after he finished playing. And then it moved on to Bobby Robson was there. Like there are so many of these guys. There are so many of these generations who've come and gone. And none of them have been able to win anything with England.
Yeah.
Like there is no inheritance. Like I think you being in Germany and having that, like there is an inheritance concept, right? Like at Bayern Munich, I think they really espouse something like this. Like you have to teach the next generation how to win. And yeah, that's what they've done with.
It comes with the board. It's come with, like, you see how Bayern is run. Like they retain their players. And they
exactly. Yes.
Like right now it's Oliver Kahn on the board. He's going to be the CEO as soon as this guy retires, or he's already retired.
Salahemich or something like that, right?
Karl Rummenigge, I don't know.
Oh, Rummenigge. Okay, yeah. Salahemich is the CEO. My bad, yeah.
And now that Oliver Kahn is there, then he...
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
He will get in Philipp Lahm soon and then Schweinsteiger. And then these two will bring... Yeah, who's the next generation? Neuer and Goretzka and Kimmich and all those players. So
Müller is an obvious one, isn't he?
Yeah. And that's how it works. So, but yeah, we drifted a little bit trying to like really go hard on the English.
Yeah, no. It's just a way of looking at how these things are done. Like, actually, funnily enough, this is the first England generation that has actually won something. They won an under-17 World Cup, which was held back in India. So,
and
the guy who was actually on that team, which is, I believe, Jadon Sancho was on that team. He doesn't play for the starting team. He doesn't start for England.
Yeah.
So it's a joke all around. I mean, it's a joke.
Yeah, in shambles.
Anybody who's still... Like, I still think a lot of people are into the fact that, England are still there. They're still set up. Like, English fans, people who live in England, fair enough. Honestly, what else are you supposed to do other than support your home team, like your home country? I find that to be fair. Yeah. But there's a lot of pundits. Like, pundits are supposed to be kind of unbiased, right? And regardless of what language you speak in or which nationality you belong to, you have to be objective.
Yeah.
And then there is the punditry, and then there's a lot of fans from countries who, like from our countries, for example, or like from China or from any of these countries which are not actually playing the tournament. Like those guys have hyped England up, and they have it that delusion in their heads that because we watch the Premier League, we know the talents, we know how good they are, the best league in the world, garbage that is there. Barely functional, barely functional in the sense like financially inept because of external circumstances. Like that Villarreal team, which beat United in the final, it had external circumstances due to which it does not have the finance.
Yeah.
And they were able to beat Manchester United, one of the biggest clubs in the world, the richest clubs in the world. And you still pretend as if England is still the best league in the world and the best players all come here. It's the most financially profitable league in the world. It's not the best in the league in the world.
I'm glad you said that. I really wanted to do a podcast on this. Like, it's not the best.
We'll do it. I'm in, dude. Because I watch the Premier League all the time. But I'm I don't want to be under that cloud that the players that I'm not watching are not good. Like, and you don't have to watch everything. It's not possible to watch everything. So you listen to people who are watching shit you're not watching. And people don't want to do the research. I might sound arrogant. I don't even care. I've put in my work. I listen to a lot of things. And that is why I'm speaking these things. And that is why we are trying to discuss this. Because you know some things I don't. I know some things you do. And we are exchanging information, right? So I mean, it's stupid. Like this idea that the league that I'm watching is the best in the world because I'm watching it. You're a moron. Like I should look into the camera. You're a fucking moron if you think so.
Oh my God. Okay. Yeah. Let's call the game. Deutschland gegen England.
Let's take Germany. Fuck this. I'm not going to pick England after this. I under no circumstance can do that. But I honestly, if you ask me for an honest, objective opinion, I think England have the edge in this game.
Why?
The German team is crossing thing doesn't work, dude. That's my only issue. Like if they figure out that thing.
They're also playing in Wembley, but as though that support.
That means very little to me.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not a big variable to me. Wembley is not the most hospitable stadium to play in. Like it's not Turkey. It's not Galatasaray Stadium or Besiktas or Vespas Stadion or Sevilla or it's not one of the, Anfield. Like it's not even Anfield. Like if the game was happening at Anfield, completely different story. Completely different story. It's a completely different magic there. Like it's Anfield for God's sake.
Yeah,
come
I
on.
Mean, anyways, the Germans wouldn't find it intimidating. Like you fill 90,000 members.
Yeah, I think the Germans are the most prepared team in that sense, aren't they? They know how. They went into Hungary and were able to handle that. Like.
They played all the games.
No, they didn't go to Hungary, did they? They played the odd matches in Hungary. Like they all three games were in Munich for Germany. Yeah. Yeah. Ah, okay. Yeah, so, I don't buy this German team much though. Like I don't buy the crossing thing. Like I don't get it. Like I don't get why they keep trying that.
But they have a favorable draw. They cannot like complain. Like even though they've been awful, they should get to the semi.
Yeah.
Okay. And how
they
can
should
they get...
like they.
Yeah. And how can they get to the semis is playing one of the two teams that we are going to preview next, which is Sweden against Ukraine.
Yeah.
And yeah, Ukraine made it huffed and puffed away, but Sweden should be too strong for them.
Unless... Yeah, that's pretty self-explanatory. Like, and like the biggest doubt we had about the Sweden team before this game, they don't seem capable of scoring and they shut that thing down in our face. Like they conceded too, fair enough. But like that ability to actually take that step and set, because the goals that they scored were good goals. They were well set up goals. They were well coordinated goals.
And
like,
why did they concede two goals? Is because they were also trying to score goals. So which up. They couldn't score in the first.
It's Robert Lewandowski. You give him a whiff, he'll score. Like that's kind of a reasonable explanation for that, isn't it?
Oh yeah. So I think that's a fairly mismatched 65-35 game. But yeah, so on the whole, we already have our predictions. Let's run that through again. First game is who?
Wales-Denmark, right? Wales-Denmark and then Italy-Austria.
You're going for Wales. I'm going for Denmark. The second game, both of us are going for Italy. Third game, Netherlands-Czech.
Netherlands. Yeah.
Belgium, Portugal.
We are split on this. I'm on Portugal side, you're on Belgium. Like, I have to pick Bruno Fernandes, man. Like, I just have to because, like, I don't care for him too much in the Portugal team. Actually, my pick for the championship is Portugal because Bruno Fernandes has been like a savior for me. Like, I look at him that way. It's not like I'm not going to take, like, he has flaws and stuff like that. It's not that. But the way he's revolutionized, like, he's the single biggest reason why Manchester United are in a much better place than they were 1.5 years ago. So, I'm going to pick Portugal as my team to win this tournament.
And we also split on the next one, Croatia-Spain. I'm going for Spain.
Yeah.
But not the next one, Switzerland-France. France should,
Can you give me one reason? Like I feel kind of we kind of left it empty-handed. Like, can you give me one thing that the Switzerland team can do that maybe France have a problem?
I don't know, Shaqiri whipping a free kick in the 90th minute with the scores 0-0.
Yeah, that could be true. That's something that could actually be quite realistic because this France team, I don't know. They don't attack enough, dude. Like that's going to bite them in the ass. Like that, I get that feeling. Like you know, because they sit back, they relax a bit too much sometimes. They get too content with that one goal lead. Like In these kinds of tournaments, because you just need one chance. Like it can kill you. And this kind of hubris is what's going to kill the France team if something does.
Yeah.
Like just. Just go for it, man. You have Kylian Mbappe and Paul Pogba. Just try and smash them. Like, kill them.
Yeah. And then
it's frustrating, isn't it? Like when you have the best squad in the world and you still and don't go easy. For it a lot
yes,
of the time.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Like it's just frustrating to watch. Like I understand the project. I understand why they do it. It's yeah. I'm not denying that it works because they've won a World Cup, but it's still frustrating. Like it's I, at the end of the day, we are fans. Like we want to enjoy good football. We want to see the best players do their thing. Mm-hmm. Like,
yeah. And then we have the split on this one. I mean, we are not having a podcast after the 29th of June.
Oh my God.
If this happens. Oh my God. If they start.
I can't believe I went on that rant and I enjoyed it so much. I can't tell you how much I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Okay. They better be professional. As long as Germany are professional, they should like spank the shit out of England.
Yeah.
And yeah. And then Sweden, Ukraine. Yeah, Ukraine, not that. They are not there for Sweden.
Yeah.
It should be a
well, actually, they have a chance. Like, the front line has to click. Like, the front line has to click. Because Yaremchuk looked a bit off in the games, a couple of games. Like, if they click, if the front line is in sync, they have a chance to fight the Sweden team. And that would be a good game. Like, actually, none of the games are kind of disappointing. Except the France-Switzerland one. I have a feeling that's going to be boring. Mm-hmm. But I'm excited for the rest. Like, the Belgium-Portugal is obviously going to be one of the best fixtures.
Yeah.
And I'm very hopeful of Wales-Denmark. I think that's something that's going to be awesome.
Yeah,
like, two teams which feel very eager and they enjoy playing with each other.
And
that is something I will always respect.
Mm-hmm. True. Well, on that note, yeah. Let's see how our predictions for these pre-quarterfinals come about. And hope you enjoy these games starting on Saturday. And we are going to see you again back with the morning after the Euros every day after the pre-quarterfinals has happened. And we also preview the next.
Are we doing one the day after also? Like, I mean, Saturday. Like, are we recording one on Saturday?
We'll see what we can talk about. But at the moment, this is the time.
Maybe we should have planned it a bit. We could have done the rants in another episode or something.
Yeah. All right. Stay cool, guys. We'll see you soon. Bye.